I work for Northern Water, and since 2010 have been working with Tom on the research farm at Greeley, looking at deficit irrigation as an option to meet a growing demand for water along the Front Range. Our population is increasing about 3% per year, a strong pressure on irrigated ag to use the concept of buy and dry, but we don't like that. We want to keep irrigated ag or some form of it in existence to feed the world as a sink for CO2 and the lifestyle of a rural community for future generations. And through Northern, we think that deficit has a role of continuing some level of irrigation on the farms. And what I want to talk about today quickly is two approaches to deficit, and the approaches involve the most critical thing in foundation of Colorado water law, and that's maintaining historic return flows. You know, Jeff mentioned that we need to quantify ET, but in a transfer, quantifying ET needs to the next big question is, of the water applied, you had this ET, and the difference is return flows. And our Colorado water law and the foundation of it is in time, location, and amount, you have to maintain those historical return flows because that's the supply for downstream water rights. Everything we do, augmentation plans or change of use, is about maintaining return flows. And how do we do that in a deficit scheme is what I want to talk to you about. And the two approaches is really the level of monitoring, an extensive monitoring system or a simple system. So specifically why Northern is interested in this as an ATM rather than the traditional buy and dry is Northern, as you'll learn on the tour Friday, is a sponsor for some new storage projects. And you'll go to the Glade Reservoir site. Glade Reservoir is a new reservoir site, but it has a 1994 water right, very junior. It's only going to fill when there's free river and lots of river. And we've committed to the participants of the NIST project that we'll come up with a 40,000 acre foot firm yield, hopefully mostly through filling Glade Reservoir and Galeton Reservoir with junior water rights. But what if we get into an extended drought? To firm up 40,000, we're going to have to turn to senior ag rights, and whether it be rotational fallowing or some form of deficit, and not doing buy and dry, Northern Water is interested in that type of an ADI program. For those that went on the tour, the Greeley farm where a lot of this work has been done with Northern Water and CSU is right about in here, which is under the new cash ditch, which is the major ditch that Northern Water would want to do a augmented deficit irrigation program with. You were at the farm on Tuesday, the Limited Irrigation Research Farm, and you saw Kendall and Tom gave a tour. The bulk of their research on that farm is drip irrigation, both surface drip and buried. Northern Water has sort of, ARS has allowed Northern Water to come in and study deficit under furrow irrigation. So we've got 5 acres here, 5 acres here, and we're leasing an additional 15 acres. And this project really started back in 2010 when a private corporation came to ARS and said, well, we'd like to work with you on study deficit and develop software and hardware to help monitor it. And Don Sanford and Deanna Dernford are here. They're working on those systems, and they have a new platform called SWIM, Sustainable Water and Innovative Irrigation Management, where they've developed hardware and software to monitor deficit and applying it extensively in California right now. But these studies that Northern has been involved in are what are termed as low frequency deficit compared to the deficit studies by USDA with drip is high frequency. They irrigate a couple times a week with small amounts, which they can do with drip, with no deep perk. So what they apply is deep perk. A bigger challenge on furrow irrigated fields where we're operating at 60% efficient and you have deep perk and we're practicing low frequency deficit where we take the profile on these corn fields down to pretty much using all the soil moisture up and giving it then maybe 2 irrigations during the season to completely refill the profile compared to 6 or 7 on the fully irrigated. And part of this study is also looking at agronomic practices on how we can maintain water productivity under severe deficits that you have with low frequency deficit. So again, the context of augmented deficit irrigation is this whole reliance on return flows. The South Platte Basin is driven by return flow hydrology. The way water rights have developed, the South Platte River, which is a 10 million acre foot aquifer, is a tributary aquifer that drains to the river 5 to 10 CFS per mile. The South Platte River up the Poudre River where we're here drains the aquifer. And water rights have been developed downstream that rely on that drainage from the aquifer. From the mouth of the canyon on the Poudre to the state line at Julesburg, in the middle of summer, we'll dry up the river 7 times, but it immediately starts gaining below those dry up points, which meets downstream water rights. So absolutely essential that those return flows be maintained as we start to change irrigation practices, whether you dry up a farm, the criteria is all you can move is your consumptive use. The return flows that occurred from that historical irrigation practice have to be maintained. Any deficit study, as Jeff mentioned, starts with a change of use report, because that's a measure of your historical consumptive use and also your historical return flows. And a change case has been done on the New Cache Ditch, and they did a change case on some of their shared water because they have 60 wells under that ditch system, and those wells are junior water rights, you know, 1930 to 1970. Those well water rights are pumping from a tributary aquifer. They're essentially, those wells are depleting return flows. So one of the biggest forms of augmentation plans that go through water courts is if existing wells want to pump, they have to replace those, their consumptive use of historic return flows. And New Cache has changed some of their shares. What's interesting is right here, note that 18 inches for grain corn is the irrigation water requirement. And during the summer plus winter carryover moisture, adding 6 to 7 inches, on average, our historical use for fully irrigated grain corn is about 24, 25 inches. 18 inches being the IWR from the irrigation water. So what this report does is they take that 18, they assume a field efficiency of 0.6. You know, 0.6 into 18 is 30 inches. So on average, 30 inches is applied to the fields, 18 is consumed, 12 of it is return flows. And part of the discussion, negotiation, compromise, and going through water court is of that 12 inches, how much is deep perk and how much is surface runoff? And in this case, it was about 10 inches of deep perk, 2 inches of runoff. So if you change some of the shares or do deficit, you're going to have to maintain that level of both deep perk and surface runoff. How do we do that? So the two approaches are, can we maintain the historical return flows as part of the deficit irrigation practices? Meaning that when I give this cornfield 2 irrigations, I completely draw down the profile, extensive stress, we monitor that stress, then I irrigate and completely fill the profile, and through a water balance confirm that the deep perk has been met. You know, between profile filling irrigations, you know, it's simple water balance to determine deep perk. ET monitoring, getting it right, is essential for both quantifying through this that we've met the deep perk, and to confirm that the daily, an ET monitoring on a daily basis of the water stress corn is that 9 inches. Because remember, of that 18 inches for fully irrigated historic corn, we want to lease 9 inches to the city. So extensive monitoring and detailed monitoring, and you're going to have a lot of fun with objectors proving this. But what you get out of this is that within the deficit irrigation practices, you are maintaining historical return flows. With these 2 irrigations on these loam soils where I overfill the profile, yes, I operate less efficiency, I overfill the profile, That 12 inches, of which 10 was deep perk for historic return flows, in those two irrigations, I am meeting that deep perk requirement of 10 inches. So within the irrigation system of the deficit, low frequency deficit, I have proven, and now working on it, consistently proving it, that the deep perk is meant, and confirming that there was 9 inches of stress DT. The other technique is a simpler one where the farmer only is going to receive 9 inches of historic consumptive use. That's all he's going to get. That's all I'm going to give him. The other 12 inches that was historical return flow from historical practices, I'm going to meet a different way. I'm going to meet with recharge ponds and augmentation flumes. So instead of the deep perk occurring on the farmer's field as it has historically, I've got a recharge pond near his farm or under the ditch system where the 10 inches of historic deep perk goes into a recharge pond and the 2 inches of surface runoff goes to an augmentation station back to the river. The only monitoring in that sense is measure water on. Pretty simple, straightforward, less controversy. Just types of measuring systems that are going to be needed. Within a mile of the research farm, the New Cash system has developed an aug plan where they have recharge ponds off of their ditch. You measure water in, subtract evaporation, that seeps into the aquifer. Here within a mile of the research farm is an augmentation station where part of the ditch flow is dumped out of the New Cash ditch through a measuring flume, and that goes on a drainway back to the Poudre River down here. You know, on-farm monitoring, you know, on the deficit systems, water's measured on with flow meters, measured off with ramp flumes. We have a Greeley 4 weather station there to get reference ET. And we also, from a weather station, which is, I think, we're underutilizing a good weather station, we can get a well-irrigated canopy temperature on an hourly basis. You know, Jackson and Itso in the 1980s used that theoretical approach. But in addition to getting reference ET, we can get a well-irrigated canopy temperature for corn. We're calibrating it. We're measuring with a little IRT grass. And if you were there, we've got a little alfalfa field here. We're doing it. We're also doing some soil moisture monitoring. We have watermark sensors, neutron probe, and trying some handheld soil moisture monitoring, a portable TDR, just as a cross check, maybe at the beginning of the end of the season, sort of to close the water balance. So rest of the talk is about ways to really tie down that stress DT. When that crop is in water stress, how do we monitor it? And I'm totally sold on satellite monitoring. Rick's talked about it. We've worked with CSU a lot on the remote sense DT from Landsat. It's like metric, but from Landsat, you know, you can get actual ETC, actual crop ET, with it even stressed, divided by a reference ET from a weather station is a good stress coefficient. It's sort of a flag, maybe every 16 days with more satellite, maybe more. Also, in working with CSU in the South Platte Basin for 5 years, they've developed a regional crop coefficient curve for corn based on growing degree days, which is a good index. And that curve is a really good curve. If we compare that curve, which is this blue line, to the LRF well-irrigated corn that Kendall and Tom grow with 100% ET being met, and you look at that growing degree day curve, it falls pretty good on top of their daily soil water balance approach for full ET of the fully irrigated plot. And when you apply that curve then to their deficit plots, which are the green, the difference between a daily soil water balance for the deficit and this curve for fully irrigated would be a measure of reduced or saved ET through water stress. Right now, this is your standard KS. That's in FAO or other publications, which is just a function of declining soil moisture. So besides knowing your historical ET through a change of use, by knowing a well-irrigated canopy or well-irrigated reference ET and comparing it to a daily soil water balance of deficit, you can get your saved ET as another cross-check. Also, we're working out there on different ways to monitor the stress index, some really simple ways, such as the old crop water stress index, but what we're doing it with is, well, wet washcloth, dry washcloth, and leaf temperature. So a crop water stress index being leaf temperature minus wet, dry minus wet, measured with a Home Depot $30 little IRT, works pretty good. But part of that stress coefficient, and that's a representation, yeah, the leaves heat up by the energy balance, and that's an indication of closed stomates. But also in corn and other crops, you also are reducing leaf area. So that stress index is both a KS, which is representing sort of intensity of the leaves, closed stomate, the heat up, but it also factors in percent ground cover, because that's often a bigger factor when corn, the leaves go upright or curl. You reduce ground cover, reducing the energy load, conserving water. So we came up with a simple light stick, 30 inches long, marked every inch and a half. You count the shaded and you get a percent ground cover. Here's some really stressed corn. Hadn't seen water for a month, about a 15% ground cover. And based on this temperature difference, with a KS being 1 minus this, this KS was about 0.3 times 0.15. You know, the coefficient KS times GC was 0.05 times reference. This crop here isn't losing much water. And always take pictures, because crops show that they're stressed. And to be able to correlate some simple measurements with pictures of stress is just a good way to index for the future. And this project, Developing Simple Ways, was a cooperative project of Northern Water, CSU, and the Colorado Corn Growers, because they're really interested in helping farmers determine effects on yield of stress, and what are some simple ways that we can monitor and quantify stress and then compare it to resulting yield. Also, through this project, you know, smartphones, you can get a thermal IR camera now, which has a lot of potential for the future. And Kendall's got some, who's talking next, has got some good videos of this. So you can get a visual picture and a thermal picture just on your smartphone, and then with some software that hopefully will be in the cloud, but you take it back to your PC, you can get transects of leaf temperature. What's interesting, if you take these leaf temperature in the sunlight compared to an average temperature of this image, and remember, an apogee IRT that's looking at the canopy oblique to just get canopy temperature is doing a composite temperature. And we see that if you compare sunlit to sunlit leaves to an image from an apogee, it's about, the sunlit leaves are about 7% higher. And I mentioned that from weather stations, these are some of the best relationships I get, and it proves the energy balance, that with temperatures of an apogee sensor oblique on a corn canopy, and compare it on an hourly basis, when you have adiabatic stability greater than 1 meter wind speed, you get an excellent relationship of a well-irrigated corn canopy temperature compared to that measured in the field. So all of a sudden, a lot of people say you need a well-irrigated plot to get a well-irrigated canopy temperature to compare stress temperatures to. No, compute it from hourly weather data. That's a good, but also consistently, the slope of this is like 6% higher than the measured. Again, we measured is shaded, while Penman Monteith computed well-irrigated canopy temperature is the big leaf model, assuming all leaves are sunlit. So this 6% increase in the Penman Monteith over measured is basically because your apogee IRT sensor is measuring some shaded leaves. But having a well-irrigated reference canopy temperature is a really good way to develop stress indexes, whether it be the ratio that Balch came up with of well-irrigated to stress times some factor that maybe requires local calibration, or the one I like is with Bloomquist, that once you measure canopy temperature, recognizing this effect, you can compute a canopy conductance. And maybe a canopy conductance ratio where a well-irrigated corn canopy is about 80 second meters or 500 millimoles per meter squared per second. You can compute a canopy conductance, and that ratio of stress canopy conductance times percent ground cover, because the corn plants are have been curled up and there's not as much ground cover. Times reference has been one of the best things I've seen calibrating to a soil water balance. Also at Northern, along the lines of what Mark was talking about, to help track this, just some easy software that someone could have on their smartphone. Working with two companies in Sterling, this is likewise, but it's sort of, you don't need GIS, you give some simple data on your crop. Tell me it's a loam soil, it's corn, when it was planted, and an estimate of your soil profile. And then this will send you automatically every day at your choice of time of the day an email update, you know, of your field every day. So precip since the last 24 hour, what crop ET has been, your soil water remaining, and the water to refill. You know, when I'm practicing deficit, this turns negative and red, and I'll take this down to 3-4 inches, and my corn's looking like heck before I irrigate it, but I'm harvesting my crop, which is safe consumptive use. So just a handy little way, because farmers are often too busy to log onto a website or keep up an app on their phone. This is sort of, every farmer has corn prices sent to him daily. We're just sending to him some water balance information to sort of give an indicator of where he stands, which is both helpful in irrigation management, but helpful in deficit scheduling. This is the funnest part of working in the field is in, how am I doing for time? I can be long-winded and soapboxy. Okay. One of the most interesting things is in the field is, are there agronomic practices that we can use in deficit irrigation to maintain water productivity? So when we go into stress with a grain crop, and it's very specific to grain crops, it really doesn't work on vegetative yielding crops, that as soon as you start reducing ET, you lose turg, or not even reducing ET, you lose turg, or you lose vegetative yield. But in reproductive crops like corn, are there agronomic practices that we can maintain that water productivity, maintain the yield? Can we get to 100% yield at 70% ET? Or can we get 80% grain corn yield at 50% ET? And are there agronomic practices that can help us move in that direction? And the two most promising ones we've seen is the drought varieties of corn, which we're using two different seed companies, and going to twin row corn. And what those two things do is it assures me of getting to full ground cover no matter how much stress I've had during the vegetative stage. Because when I'm stressed in the vegetative, I'm not producing leaves, expanding and covering the ground. But if I can spread out my plants more with twin row corn, so every 30 inches I plant two corn rows 9 inches apart compared to 30 inch standard planting, still at 35,000 plants per acre with their own little homemade twin row planter that actually will plant in a diamond pattern. This 30 inch row, their plants are 6 inches apart, with twin row and triangulating the seeds, I'm about 11 inches between corn plants. And one thing about plants, when they're in severe stress, it's about plant-to-plant competition. And the more space you have between plants, the better they do. 5 minutes, okay. The other thing is the drought-tolerant varieties, one of the main, and we're trying to understand what is it about the drought-tolerant varieties. And one of the main things is they have a laid-out leaf structure. Compared to your more traditional corn that most people grow now with the upright leaf structure, under deficit, on 30-inch rows, I can't get this to full ground cover. This I can be assured of getting to full ground cover, because when it goes into stress, it folds and rolls its leaves and closes its stomates, saves ET. But when it comes out of stress, the leaves are laid out and you're assured of getting to full ground cover. And one of the biggest factors in maintaining grain corn yield as you move from pollination into grain fill is if you're going into grain fill with full ground cover, you're going to minimize your yield loss. And with twin row, with drought varieties, we're the best we've done so far is an 85% yield at 63% ET, or a water productivity ratio, divide those two, of 1.35. That's the way I like to talk. That means 35% more bushels of corn per inch of ET. Finally, last slide, to get a long-term relationship between cities and farmers, it's got to be beneficial to both. We've talked about the sort of the technical aspects, but the institutional economic aspects you can't overlook. How do you get farmers always wanting to do deficit? And the only way you're going to want them to only do deficit is if they see an increase in net profit. And the more you can increase water productivity, the more you can give the farmer a net profit, and lease rates come down, and cities are interested. And what we've done a lot of work with in talking to farmers is approaching the economic side. Well, now I did it. There we go. So what we do is we tell a farmer, you get involved in a deficit program as part of your rotational problem, a process. A net profit on farm with deficit plus lease of the city of the saved CU, we're going to increase your net profit X percent. So if I say a farmer, you do deficit, I'm going to increase your profit 20%. That's our current price of corn. You know, gross, it's about a dollar net right now. Farmers are suffering. $5 corn. But this price also has to be keyed to the price of corn. But you can see as you increase water productivity and you keep more yield on the farm, more net profit on the farm, you know, think about if you could get 100% yield at 70% ET, the farmer's getting his full net profit on the farm, and the saved CU leased to the city is really gravy to the farmer. This is sort of the range of increasing water productivity we've done. The best we've done is, again, with twin row and drought varieties. You can see the difference. If you fallow and no yield on the farm, of course you're going to pay the most because there's no net profit on the farm, so the entire incentive for the farmer is through the lease and payment. So again, increases in water productivity on farm with deficit means more affordable to M&I. They love prices like this compared to buy and dry and taking it through water court, but they want the security and certainty that these leases are always going to be there. And the approach is, if we can always make this attractive to the farmer, you know, if corn gets to $8 a bushel, we probably can't compete. And it really depends on the price of corn, and you got to key it to that. So again, and just in conclusion, a northern water deficit program we think are valuable for the future to help us firm up our new storage projects. We want farmers to try deficit. Here's some new approaches for the future: twin row corn, drought variety corn, other things we're trying out there, different tillage systems, with the goal of supplying front range growth through both new storage but also some senior water transferred. But we hope we do it through deficit because we don't like buy and dry. We need irrigated agriculture to stick around. So thank you very much.